for Zoom, which is taking me over to Facebook. So bear with me. And in the thing. And we are live. I believe we are live. Yes, I think we're live, everybody. Yeah, hi, everybody. This is Brett from Heinemann. And we are live right now with Mary Aaronworth, Mark Todd, and Pablo Wolf. And we want to start with, you know, how do we establish community with our students, you know, while we're trying to manage different classroom situations as we begin this very unique school year? We thought we'd take a moment tonight to talk about how we can start the school year off with a focus on identity work for students and teachers in order to build community in our classrooms, whatever it looks like for you right now. So to talk more about this topic, we're joined by the authors of the forthcoming book, The Civically Engaged Classroom, Reading, Writing, and Speaking for Change by Mary Aaronworth, Pablo Wolf, and Mark Todd, who joined me now. Welcome, everybody. And, you know, let's start with this, Mary.
Hi, everyone.
What kind of identity work will help teachers and students create the foundation of a civically engaged classroom?
Well, it's interesting you ask that, Brett, because we started this book and wrote the manuscript before we suffered an international global pandemic and before we had so many long overdue protests in this country and around the world. And now I think when we think about community, I think we actually think more about collectivity, of the notion of really celebrating kids' distinct identities and having multiple ways. So it's not so much that there's one technique, although we are going to share some different ways of doing this work with you tonight, so much as it's a stance of valuing the fact that when the kids come to school, we're going to want to do some work to actually figure out ways to amplify and to expand and to investigate their identities. So we're going to try four different things tonight that we think might be interesting and helpful for you when you start the school year. We're going to do some work with imagery. We're going to do some work with expression walls. We're going to do some work with identity mapping. And we're going to do some work with poetry. And we think any or all of those could be ways that when you first start the school year, you can show kids that their lives matter. Okay, so I'm going to turn you over to Pablo to get started.
Hi, everyone. So much of this identity work, it's super important that we start with ourselves. We spend a lot of time as teachers researching other texts, but we don't always think about who we are when we come into the classroom. So a lot of this work that we're doing today will start with doing with ourselves. My favorite book about teaching is from Parker J. Palmer. It's called The Courage to Teach. And he has this lovely, lovely line about identity where he says, I quote here, "My ability to connect with my students depends less on the methods I use than on the degree to which I know and trust my selfhood and am willing to make it available and vulnerable in the service of learning." And so what we do tonight is going to open up ourselves. We're going to try to be vulnerable in front of our students and with each other tonight. And we're going to put that in the service of learning. So the first thing I'm going to ask that we do is that we try a little bit of image work to represent our emotional and psychological state right now in this pandemic moment that we're in right now. So I'm going to ask you to, if you were to pick an image that represents your current mental, psychological, emotional state, what would that image be? And that image could be a meme, it could be something, a famous piece of artwork, it could be a GIF, and you could just drop it right in the Facebook comments. So it wouldn't be fair to ask you to do it if I didn't do it first and if we didn't do it first. So Mary, maybe you can show some of the images that we picked to represent our current states of mind.
Absolutely. Give me just 1 second. here, we'll go back. Sorry. Let's go here. So this is, let's start with yours, Pablo. That's the image that Pablo chose.
Do you want to say? So here's mine. So don't be frightened away by my image. My image is a picture from the famous painter. He's an Ecuadorian painter, Oswaldo Guayasamin. And this is called Las Manos de la Protesta, which means the hands of protest. So right now I've got like a bit of anger and a little bit of angst in me. And I think these hands express that well. So that's my image for my moment. What about yours, Mark?
I have two. I love the Muppets. So I think they bring such joy, but also some honesty. I feel like there's two things inside. I feel like I'm Kermit the Frog just listening to hear any word they're going to give us about what's going to happen this school year, even a date for starting. At the same time, then privately, I'm breathing into a bag, trying to remain calm, because I know our staff are going to need us to be calm when they arrive.
Oh my gosh. This one's mine. I've been up in the remote peninsula of New Hampshire for 6 months now since the pandemic started, but I've gone back to New York twice. Once was to go down to take care of some medical stuff, but the other one was to drive down to go to a protest, because it just felt like when our whole city was up and protesting, and one of the most beautiful things about the protest was seeing so many kids of all ages. And it really gives you hope to see kids out in, the, you know, and this is a time when it's a dangerous time to be protesting for a lot of different reasons. And that was really, really beautiful.
Yes.
So teachers, as you think about teachers and colleagues, as you think about your current state of and frame of mind, if you're comfortable, go ahead and share it in the comment section. Just drop an image in there or a link to an image. Or if you'd like to describe it, if it's not working for you, that's fine. We'll look forward to looking at those after the live is over to see what kinds of wonderful things you put on there. So one thing that's really helpful for us to think about is who we are, what we bring into the classroom emotionally. And that's one way to do it. We can also think about having the students do similar types of work. And this can work live in the classroom or it can work virtually. So as we move on, Mark is going to share us some really cool ways that he's created community using some virtual tools. Mark, can you tell us a little bit about expression walls?
Yes. Mary, can you share that if that's possible?
Yeah, absolutely. And did you want me to give a little bit of the background for some of the research we were going to talk about maybe?
Yes, would you?
Yeah, so I think before even we show a wall, we just wanted to share two articles with you, and then I'll give Mark his time to talk to you because he's got so much to say. But there are two articles that I think right now would be really worth you possibly reading. And one is by Bettina Love. She's got this article called Teachers, We Cannot Go Back to the Way Things Were. And in here, she is pleading with us to say that when we go back to school in the fall, can we actually not go back to business as usual, but can we strive to make it better? And she's particularly concerned for Black and Brown kids and for kids who are underrepresented or whose voices were not amplified in school, but in fact, sometimes were made to feel marginalized or to be outsiders in school. And one of the things that she looks at that will be really relevant to the work that Mark's about to show you is she looks at assessment, and she says that a lot of the ways that we assess kids are that we're assessing them in ways where only some kids can flourish even in our assessments. And so she's begging us to get assessments and to think about ways to assess kids where we're able to see more kids more fully. And then there's another article that I'm just going to pull up right here, which was by the Washington Post, which was called, Can We Stop Telling the Corona Kids How Little They Are Learning? And this is going to be another thing that's really important when we go back to school, that we don't go back to school with a deficit model, that we're not going back thinking the kids have not been learning for many months. They have been learning many, many, many things. The three of us were really struck right before the pandemic kind of unleashed in the United States. Sara Ahmed had been to Teachers College, and she gave this stunning keynote, the title of which was When the World Hands You a Curriculum. And you know, if ever the world has handed us a curriculum, it's been in the last few months. And the truth is the kids have been learning a lot of really complicated things, from living through a historic pandemic, through living through times of unfairness and injustice and protest and coalition and hope, to doing chores with their families, to trying to get along with our families in very small spaces. There've been so many things that the kids have been learning. So I'm gonna show you, first I'll just show you some images because you're gonna be so struck. And Mark and I were thinking that these are from Mark's expression wall. Could you just use the comment box to write down some words that describe the emotions you see kids having? And then Mark's gonna tell us how he got this going. So let me open up, Mark, I'll open up for your, here we go. Let me just pull it up. And so this is very early in March. These are Mark's seventh graders. What words would you put down to describe their emotions? Yeah, it feels like lonely and isolated and anxious. It feels awesome to them. It feels confusing.
Ominous.
Yeah, ominous. David, I can't even see the outside world. Maybe they even feel a little desperate. And then let's go forward.
I see Liam feels like a war.
Yeah, it feels like a war. I mean, it's like, so one of the things that I think is so interesting about this, when you think about what Bettina Love says about, you know, how can our assessments help us see more kids more fully? I feel like the work that Mark is doing here, this is work that he invented during the pandemic that we should not drop when we go back to school, because it's a different way of seeing kids. Like, I think a lot of times in schools, we don't get to see kids' emotions, especially adolescents, where they feel like their job is to hide their emotions so often, mm-hmm. and their emotions are so changeable. And then this is a little later. So this is now like April to May. What would you say? I'd say they're trying to be hopeful. They're trying to be collaborative. Mm-hmm. They're trying to care for their community. They're trying to be compassionate.
Hope.
Mm-hmm. And then this is so interesting to me. You know, now they're outraged. Mm-hmm. And they're caring in a different way.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I think I would say, I mean, would you say, I feel like they were isolated at the beginning, Mark, but here it feels to me like maybe they're engaged. Like they're engaged in a really intimate way with the world around them. So it's, This is what the curriculum has been for the kids. And I think one of the things is we wouldn't say that they haven't been learning. So Mark, can you tell us a little bit about how you did this work and just tell me if you want me to go back and show any other images?
Oh, sure. If you just want to go back to the first slide. Yeah, this is good. I just knew as soon as we were heading home and it was going to be March, I knew I needed to create something so that students can have an outlet. And I didn't want anything to, I didn't want feedback on it because I wanted it to feel just safe where they could post something. And of course I had to model it. I gave them a choice really early on if it's a poem or music, because when I am down or if I need inspiration, I will play a song or our students will watch a movie over again. So I was just trying to lead them to those places that gave them hope, I guess. I was trying to figure out what they needed.
And did you have some prompts, but it seems like for a while they were doing images out their window, and then they were doing like posters, or and then later they did videos. And did you have a kind of, not really, I don't know if you'd call it a theme for the week, or like how did you get it so the kids were?
I just had a theme for a week and they had all week to do it, and they can post as much as they want. And also I showed them, I demonstrated, I would give a few examples of what it could look like. And this is Padlet, which was a new technique for them. So I also had to show them how to download. It was a question, I would have a reminder. Then when we would have, synchronous teaching, I could highlight a picture, or if we were meeting for homeroom, I could say, I love that post that you did. Or David, I can't even see the outside world. It gave me a chance I could check in on David to make sure that he was all right, and also possibly talk to their family, you know, just to see that David's all right, because David is a only child. So it's just, can you imagine if that was your only view for 6 months or 4 months, I guess.
There's something really evocative about this. And I'm thinking about some of the work that Toni Morrison has done, where she talks about the role that the arts play in times of trouble and times of strife. And it feels like something you're bringing into your, you know, your social studies classroom, Mark, where you're bringing in this role of letting the kids start to bring in an artistic expression. And it feels like there's something really beautiful and really evocative about that.
Right, because this is their world. And so for the first time, I feel like they were able to share their world with everyone, and we could see all parts of the city. Just by sharing what's outside their window, it gave all of us a chance to see what neighborhoods were like, not just our own window. It was really interesting. Can you go to the next slide with the rainbows, the message of hopes? Right, so then I just began to think, I was asking what students needed, and I know that as citizens, I had to ask them to give something. So there was that rainbow project in Brooklyn where people would put rainbows. So even though we couldn't do it, I mean, I guess they could do it on their windows, but I also wanted to have them make rainbows and give messages of hope. If they could post something, what would they say to other people? So this is where these messages of hope came from. And I love like really creative. So I'm not sure who this is. I think someone just rolled up their t-shirts and made rainbows.
It's really pretty.
Creative, right. And then this one here is like the world's largest gathering of people, the largest human rainbow, which was really something when there was no people on the street. And can you go to the next one? This had a life of its own.
Yeah, right? You can tell that. You can tell like just the outrage.
Mm-hmm. What are you finding? Alessa's post, and I was posting some things. I guess it allowed us to grow a little bit as a community, like, and as citizens, and like our country did, but us in, at home, because they were too young to go out to the street. Maybe their older brothers and sisters did, but they went to bed at night. You know, at the start of the pandemic, they went to bed with sirens.
Yeah.
And then at dinner time, they would hear the bells ring and the pans clank. And then by, what was this, May, I guess? Yes. They were hearing this as they slept, the protesters going by their house. But also they could see different inspirations on social media and just quotes, anything. And also a message of hope. This Dash Klein, he just posted that beautiful voice of that beautiful young boy who sang, "I Just Want to Live." If you remember seeing that, it's just it's incredible.
So, I mean, when I see this, Mark, this so makes me think then of this whole, like the kids have been learning. The kids have been learning a huge amount. And so one of the things I think, friends, that we're really, across our whole book and then across the three nights that we get to be with you, or the three, you know, whenever you're watching this, because we have a lot of different time zones, we're really, really interested in helping kids become more engaged with the world and how school can be a site that isn't bringing kids separated from the world, but that our classrooms can be a place where the world and school and kids can be intersecting in ways that are really, really powerful. And Mark, I think that work with expression walls is really, really gorgeous. I think that's one way that we could keep doing that even this fall.
Oh, I'm thinking about that too. Go ahead, Pablo.
Oh, sorry. I was just gonna jump in and say that going to that image in that Washington Post article, or sorry, the article by Bettina Love that has the image of like the blue sky and the you know, the vision of what we could do after this pandemic, that schools were failing kids before and now there's an opportunity for us to rethink things. Using those virtual tools that you're using, Mark, allows kids to create a community where they otherwise would feel isolated. And you do a really beautiful job of creating a sense of we're in this together. And you can see that in the images that the kids are choosing. The author Arundhati Roy uses the metaphor of a portal, that this is a moment that's a chance to move into something new. Mm-hmm. And I think you show that really beautifully with the art and the images that the kids choose.
They're really evocative. All right, so we've got the idea of just taking single images, and then we've got this idea of collective images. And so I think one thing that we're getting from the work that Mark is doing there is this notion of the collective, how there's something really evocative and moving about seeing a community's images and a community's postings and seeing how those change over time. Because the other thing that Mark's doing there is he's not doing that as a one-time thing. He's doing that so it was over months and months and months that we were out of school, that we were in virtual learning. And it's the collective movement over time that really gives you some insight into kids' emotional and psychological change and growth. It's really fascinating. So that brings us to another way that we think that would be really important and really, I think, would give you a lot of information about your kids and your colleagues also this fall, would be to do some identity mapping. And if you haven't read Sara Ahmed's Being the Change, you must read that. Like, that is a book that you must have. So Sara Ahmed has this beautiful book called Being the Change. And it's not just beautiful, it's also really significant. And in there, one of the things that she does is she does this identity mapping. And she's really clear that identity mapping is not meant to be an icebreaker. It's meant to be a way to begin to reflect on our own identities and then be able to use those reflections over time, especially in ways that intersect with the curriculum and ways that we intersect with texts. So Mark, do you want to tell a little bit or show us a little bit about the work that we can do with colleagues to do some identity mapping as adults first?
Yeah, I'll be glad to share. I'm going to share my screen. And here we go.
Yeah.
So I did this with my social studies colleagues because you can see who I am affects how I see history. But I also wanted to, like, this could be science. This could be literacy. It could be math. And if we want to know our staff, I think our students, we need to invest in them and not just on the surface, but who they are, whatever they feel comfortable sharing. And I also know that what ails us deep inside will remain there until it comes to a surface. So I set this up, and I know everyone has done these identity maps with your name in the middle, but if we put who we are and how that affects how we see something, mm-hmm. then it changes it for everyone, right? Mm-hmm. So you can think about early on, self-identities, I am male, I am cisgender, I am queer, you can just go right down the line. My education, I can talk about education, schools that matter to me, schools of thought, locations also seem to matter, where people are from or where they have lived. And these are easy. If it's a profession, I do this why it's important for us. And also, if I'm doing this in front of students, I let them know that I really care about teaching. And mm-hmm. these are just givens. But then if you think about moments of change, right, it begins to get a little bit more serious. And if you think about losses, you can do personal losses. I usually talk about my father, who just passed away suddenly. I had someone I went to school with committed suicide. So these things then become a little bit more serious. Mm-hmm. But then if we also talk about it in civics, in national tragedy, 9/11, we can mm-hmm. talk about Nixon. We can talk about the big Great Recession. We can talk about Hurricane Sandy. And if you're from California, imagine you're talking about the wildfires. Or if you're along the Mississippi, the floods or the hurricanes, if you're along the coast. And it's always again, if you're doing this to shock someone, share something shocking, I might share that I hate sports, to be honest, or I might say something really bold just to get other people to relax and share something bold about themselves, to be honest. And I might share some secret mm-hmm. that I'm comfortable sharing in order to other people to feel brave to share some type of secret. Mm-hmm. And depending who I'm with, right, that's what you highlight. And because we're teachers, we're going to highlight changes. Mm-hmm. We're going to highlight our profession and what it means to us.
Hey, Mark, they're asking if you could show the whole page. But listen, friends, don't worry. At the end, we've taken pictures of these and we put them into a little slideshow for you that we can put on your Padlet. So, but yeah, there you go. That's great. And maybe the page that with your own identity map, Mark, because that was really beautiful. Yeah, it's interesting. Yeah.
And do you want to see what this looks like with students? Mm-hmm.
So friends, this work, and we want to give full credit to this work began with our work with Sara Ahmed, and we just cannot say enough good things about her own book and her own, all the work that she's done internationally. And then we had one spin on it that we think is also significant. Mark, can you unshare screen for just a second?
Yeah.
Mine? Thanks, dear. And one of the things that we found was really significant when we were modeling with kids is that it could be really powerful for you to also make a model at the same age at which the kids are that you're teaching. Because it turns out that the things that preoccupy you and that you remember and think about now as an adult are not precisely the same things as when you were 12 and 13 and 14 and 15 and 16. And it releases different things in the kids when they see you modeling for the age you were. I mean, this is always true in writing workshop, is that when you return, for instance, in writing workshop to childhood stories, it's often really generative in releasing stories in the kids. So let's just try that for a second. So for instance, if we were thinking about like when I was in seventh grade, it's so interesting, Mark, because one of the things that happened when I was in seventh grade, which very similar to what you were just talking about, is that there was the whole Watergate.
Yep.
And that was like a huge event in my household because my family were Democrats in a town where there weren't that many Democrats. And there was a sort of conviction that like the government would fail.
Yeah.
And so even though Watergate and Nixon were such a national disaster, this whole thing that happened wasn't a disaster. I mean, that was a really interesting process to be a part of. And then meanwhile, when I think about other things in my identity at seventh grade that shaped how I saw the world. So I think a little bit about like, my town was really, really Catholic. And my family was Irish Catholic, but my parents somehow were ex-Catholics, and there is no one less religious than a group of ex-Catholics. So my parents were essentially godless socialists. And I just think about how that made me feel sort of such an outsider. And I was always trying to keep this kind of secret, which is really interesting because like when Bernie emerged, in the last election as being able to say he was a socialist, I was like, I thought you weren't allowed to talk about that because it wasn't something we were able to talk about in my family or in my town. And then I might think too how in seventh grade for me, and I'm not sure for how you were in seventh grade, think to yourself what would go on your map, but reading was such an escape. Like it wasn't like I look at what Mark's kids did in that expression wall and I think they are so much more connected politically than I was in seventh grade. Like they have heroes and they have martyrs and they have villains. Whereas for me, I mean, it was in reading that I was learning about heroes, and it was reading that I was learning about victims. It was all in my novels. And maybe it's partly because we didn't have the role of television and social media. I mean, this was when I was in, oh my gosh, this is so long ago, but this is the kind of television that we had. It's a little hard for me to remember, but like Walter Cronkite was on television. Mark, we can remember this.
I know.
And so we had a kind of, it's that whole single story, which, at the time I didn't really think about it. When you think about that whole danger of a single story, that is really true. Like we really did only get one single perspective on the news, or at least that's how I perceive it as I look back on it. So another thing you can do is you can think about mapping at the age at which your kids are. So for some of you, that's when you were in 12th grade, for some of you were in 11th grade, and sort of what was shaping your ideas, what was shaping your identity, what was shaping your ways of thinking about yourself and others, would be things that you could be mapping for yourself on that grade at which you were. So Mark, do you want to just show us before we leave?
I wanted to ask Mark to share one thing again. Mark, can you share the identity map that has who I am affects how I respond to with the blank after it? Can you share that again, that screen?
Yes. Yes,
you can.
So one of the really cool things that Mark and I talked about with this particular activity is that blank can be filled in with so many things that can engage your students with the world. So we could fill that blank in with a headline. So who I am affects how I respond to, and then there's a headline about a current event. We could put that in there. Or it could be an image, a provocative image from the news. So who I am affects how I respond to, boom, this image that's in the news right now. And so the kids can continue to map their identities in response to what's happening in the world. And that can lead to rich conversation, a lot of introspection, and potential writing as well.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Ooh, that's wonderful.
Well, that will fit. So friends, the next time we come together, we won't do it tonight because it's its own topic, but the next time we come together in September, we are going to do some work with you on anti-bias work, especially how our own identities affect the way that we perceive knowledge and we accept and reject knowledge and we shape our response to texts and how we read them. So Pablo, that'll be really great to talk about next time too. So Mark, do you want to show an identity tree before we leave? Are you able to share a screen again?
Yes.
Or do you want me to show it? I can show. I'll show you. I can pull up the image, Mark.
Okay, good, because I thought I was sharing.
Not to worry. I'm going to pull up the image and hang on one second. It'll just take me a second. There we go. Oh, well, wait, actually, why don't we first, do you want to say a little bit just about these kids' identity maps and then you can show our identity trees?
What's really nice, these were students. And so anytime they were doing long writing about history, they could open up their notebook. And as across the year, they could add to this. And what I love about Kelly, somewhere in here, she talks about coming from Vietnam. The fear is someone who's not, who is a US citizen, but also has a different experience with the Vietnam War and just coming here to this country. And it's pretty powerful.
Mark, one of my favorite things on her map is this whole thing where she says, as being a recent immigrant, what it feels like also to go to live on the Hudson River, a river that's named after Hudson, and then to go to a school that's named after Henry Hudson. And you know, your classroom is such a not a celebration of the explorers. It's a political investigation of explorers.
And also concerned, like my cousin started doing drugs. Right? Mm-hmm. There's just aware of like there's a family problem.
Mm-hmm.
So what lies inside of us remains there until we can let it calm up to some type of surface.
Mm-hmm.
And then this is Daywans. Daywans is on the right.
Oh, sorry.
It's all right.
And then what are these? Can you tell us just a little bit about these?
Yes. Because you teach seventh graders, you have to get through the passage of time. So it's all goes with Erickson's stages of development. So they're beginning to leave behind what was a foundation and be out in the world alone. So I shared this along with them. So this is kind of from my past, from the identity, and inside is how I see myself.
Mm.
And I asked them, how do they see me? And they said, smart, nice, strict, loud. Someone said funny, someone said old. And then, so that's how other people can see me, my students.
Mm.
But also we talked about social media and the traps of social media, how I might on Twitter respond to a text from Columbia Teachers College, or when I'm at the Cape, I might post some fancy cape or who I saw on the cape. Or if I'm at an art museum, I will take a picture of the recent exhibit just to show that I, you know, put this self out there as a, I guess a cultured person, but that may not be true. But that's what I choose to put out on social media. And just being that honest, again, here, the student, right? People think they're short, but if you really take a look at the student's picture, she's like, oh, they think I'm happy, easygoing. But deep down, she says, I don't like trying new things.
Mm-hmm.
She acts happy and joyful. You know, she's shy, she's flexible, but inside she does not like change. And those really contradict who you are.
Mm-hmm.
So we can see the struggles that these students are going through. And then also the branches of it, you know, life goes on, and seventh grade might seem like an eternity, like eighth grade, they have no concept of time, mm-hmm. but just to think beyond this moment, what do you want to do?
So friends, one of the things I think that we're learning from a lot of this identity work is that having multiple vehicles for kids to explore their identities and then multiple ways that we in our classrooms can amplify those identities is going to be a really significant and powerful thing this fall. And that also kids are sort of revelatory over time, just like we are. It's not as if on the first day of class that you or they share or expose so many intimate parts of yourselves, and that you can be adding to your own maps. Like Mark started with an identity map and then he's adding to it over time. Or if we go back and if you were doing your map when you're in whatever grade you were in, you can start with things that feel fairly safe and then maybe you can move to things that feel more risky a little bit later. And that notion of you can be adding risk as the kids add risk, that's really helpful and beautiful for kids. And so Pablo, do you want to give us another vehicle? Do you want to talk, because you've done such beautiful work with poetry. Should we turn to that now?
Sure, absolutely. So our book actually starts with an admission of failure, like of abject failure. And that was my failure. So I'm going to tell you a little bit of a story of failure. This identity work is really difficult. It's pivotal, but it's really hard. And I started my school year last year as an administrator and then having to just all of a sudden jump into the classroom because we had a teacher who left in the middle of the year. So I was back in the classroom and I was facing my 100% all Black students coming in as who they perceived to be a white man. And I had my own assumptions that I was coming with. They had their assumptions. And my initial reaction to being in the situation was to be like, all right, the baton has been dropped. I have to pick it up off the track and I have to run with it. And so I picked up the baton and I went straight into the teaching. I brought in poetry that I'd used in the past, slam poetry, and I brought in hip hop, and all of it flopped. There was terrible reaction. They talked over me. They didn't listen. They didn't like it. It wasn't interesting to them. And just around that moment where I was just leaning on my chair, like, what am I going to do? I'm a disaster. And here I'm supposed to be a veteran teaching other teachers and I'm flopping. And just in that moment, I get this call from my colleague, Keisha Howell. And Keisha, if you see any of her work online, like, go for it. She'll never steer you wrong. She's amazing. And she just asked me the simple question, how much have you learned about your kids? And I thought about that for a second. And I was like, nothing. I just picked up the baton and ran. I didn't actually take the time to get to know my kids or to reveal anything about myself. And so it led me down a different path and I had to do a lot of reflection and I had to respond accordingly and recalibrate my teaching. And so I think what I'd done, I started that time with my kids filling the room with what I assumed they would be interested in, rather than creating the space that they could fill with who they were authentically. Mm-hmm. And so I recalibrated and I tried something different. And I started with some poetry, but this time writing from a cultural perspective. And so I wrote some poetry inspired by Job Raynard's book, I Remember. And it's very basic. It's a formula where the writer starts with the phrase, I remember, and just goes from there. And I framed my I Remember poem so that it would be about some of my cultural background. And so I'm just going to read my poem right here that I started with the kids. So this is, I remember Calle Orquídea. I remember the smell of arroz con pollo just off the airplane and starving. I ate plate after plate as abuela spurred me on. Come más, mijo. I remember chickens in the neighbor's yard. I remember walking to Titi Tella's house, sitting on her floral printed couches, each one sealed in clear plastic. I remember sawing down mangoes with abuelo. The fruit fell in the long grass. With pocket knife and steady hands, he sliced off the skin while I waited hungrily. I remember coqui, coqui, the sound of tree frogs after summer rain. So I started off by showing my students that poem, and then I encouraged them to explore their own poetry, starting with the phrase, "I remember," and talking about the things that made them who they were. And so gradually, and this was the beginning of the students starting to uncover little bits of themselves. And one student came up to me and said, "Oh, I'm half Dominican." And another said, "I'm Puerto Rican." And we could talk about these things. And the kids started to see me as someone a little bit different, with a little bit more past, a little bit more complexity. And then they were able to share some of their own work that we were able to put up in the walls of the room. And so the space became more one where they filled it with who they were, instead of me imposing what I thought they were going to like and who I thought they were. And so that's one powerful way that we can do this. And there's more about this in the book, of course.
I love that poem, Pablo. And you know, what's interesting is Pablo and I have worked together for years. I mean, for 10 years, and yet he can write a poem and I can see a new side of him or see something different. And that notion, there's a couple educators. So Jamila Lysiska and Bettina Love also, and April Baker Bell, they're all Black feminist scholars who are all suggesting that sometimes we don't value all kinds of kids' voices and all kinds of speaking in school. And in fact, there's a really, really beautiful book by Carla España and Luz Yadira Herrera, which is called En Comunidad, which is about particularly teaching Latinx kids, but it's not just about teaching Latinx kids, not that that would be a just, it's about any kind of kids who have the ability to translanguage and are multiliterate, and how we can celebrate that in the classroom. And I feel like your poem does that, Pablo, and it would open up possibility. There's this great scholar, Kevin Kumashiro. He ran the Center for Anti-Oppressive Education, and he's got a bunch of books on anti-oppressive education. And he says that kids learn about possibility and impossibility for their own identities through the stories they hear and the stories they don't hear in school. And so I think all of this work that we've been doing tonight, we hope that that's a way that, you know, that you are in fact giving your kids feedback. Like, all the stories we tell and the stories we don't tell are feedback to the kids over whose identities matter and whose identities count, whose voices matter, the ways that we speak and that we don't speak in class. That's all work that we want to be better at this year. And we want to make sure that kids feel like the ways that they come to school and the voices that they bring and the experiences they bring matter. And from there, then we'll be better poised to be helping to teach with them. Pablo.
And I just wanted to reiterate something that you mentioned earlier, Mary, and Mark, you mentioned it as well, is that this is not just a beginning of the school sort of thing. This does live really beautifully at the beginning of the school. It's an essential there, but it's something really important to cycle back to. Our kids' identities are evolving constantly, especially in these middle school years. If you're a middle school teacher, you know they change from like week to week almost. And so to revisit this work in light of what we're teaching and how it affects our teaching is super important. So it's something we thread throughout the year, not just something that only lives at the beginning.
No, I think that's huge, Pablo, and actually equally important for high school, having, you know, brought two kids just through high school as well, where their anxieties are shifting so much across the year. And sometimes high school can start to feel like the curriculum is already set, you know, and the fact that the kids are also the curriculum can be forgotten. So I think for both those ages. So is there anything final that we want to say? I mean, Brett, should we be turning to some questions or should we be wrapping up? What should we be doing now? That's everything we wanted to share with you tonight, friends.
I mean, I'm just in awe of all of you right now. I'm just blown away. I've learned so much just watching and just sitting here on the side learning so much. So this has been incredible. I can't thank you all enough. Let's just take a second to put the call out for questions. If anyone, we have a very captive audience right now. I have to tell you, we haven't received a lot of questions because everybody has been commenting and just been captivated. We have a little over 100 people with us at the moment. And you know, the comments have been steady throughout the entire time. Oh, sorry, Pablo, go ahead.
Share, I just wanted to add a call out. Share your I remembers. Colleagues, if you have an I remember and you want to write a few lines in the comments, I'd love to see your I remembers. That would be so cool.
What would be the first four lines of your poem? Remember.
We'll just say it clearly right now. If anybody has any questions, please get them in the chat box. Right now is the time to do it, while we sort of chat for another second here. But at the moment, you know, people are just, there's so much that they reacted to among each of you. Pablo, just the poem was so powerful. Mark, they love your identity webs.
I know, they're amazing.
We had so many comments about your identity webs and just the identity tree and just all these different things.
I have to say, friends, if we're ever allowed to be back in school and we're ever allowed to travel and we're ever allowed to actually go to someone else's school, then you have to come to Mark's classroom at seventh grade at IS-289 downtown Manhattan, because it is a place of significance.
We have one question just now from Carmen, who says, I love this. How can I bring this to the lower grades?
Okay. Friends, do you want me to talk a little bit about that, Pablo and Mark, just because we did some of that together this spring? Should I say just a couple things?
Yes.
Okay, sure. Then I'm going to take us back to our Padlet, but I'll just show you, Carmen, something for a second. And then let me just click on this and go back. One of the things that we tried with lower grades is we tried, for instance, you can see over here on the left is, at least on my screen, it's the left is Mary in grade 4, and on the right was Mary in grade 7. So this was in a fourth grade class on the left. And thinking about how, if you think about your identity first, how does that affect who do you sympathize with? And we tried it first with Read Aloud, Carmen. And I think Read Aloud is a really great place to do this, where you can start with a picture book or you can start with a video. We looked at the Supporting Act, which is this great digital Read Aloud video that you can find on YouTube. And then we thought, who, you know, which characters do we sympathize with? Who do you admire? You can also ask questions about, like, who makes you anxious? Who are you less sympathetic with? And then how is that related to the parts of yourself that you bring to the text? And so with younger kids, I'd probably be starting with this work through Read Aloud.
Mm-hmm. If it was a Padlet, I'm just imagining, like, they could, if you're teaching remotely, it's almost like they could bring their favorite book. Mm-hmm. They could bring something orange, like give them a challenge so you can see a variety of things. And if you do the colors of the rainbow, then over, you know, 6 weeks, you would have the red, orange, yellow, green, blue, purple. So you, mm-hmm. Then you can talk about the meanings of the rainbow, something that brings them comfort. And they could give something away, you know, thinking about others. What can I give? Mm. Maybe they could, I don't know what they would do, but it'd be just think about it that way. What do I need? What could I give?
Mm.
Depending how young they are.
We're receiving a lot of folks are now sharing their I remember stories in the comments. So I encourage everyone to take a moment to go back. There's beautiful, beautiful comments here. There's very well written too, I have to add. I don't have time to read them all, but thank you everyone who's been sharing your I remember. Pablo, we did have a question. Who is the author or who is the person that inspired the I remember poem? If you could share that with folks.
Sure. It's Joe Brainerd. And if you Google Joe Brainerd, I think the last name is B-R-A-I-N-A-R-D. If you Google Joe Brainerd, I remember PDF, you can get a PDF of a few sample pages from the book. And there, some of them you might have to look at first before you show the kids, because some of them are less appropriate for school, but it gives an idea of what their own poems can look like.
Great, thank you. And some housekeeping for folks that are asking. Yes, this is being recorded. It will be on the Heinemann Facebook page shortly after we conclude, so you can see the beginning. We had a few folks that couldn't catch the beginning. We're also going to be taking this video over to the Heinemann blog a little later, probably tomorrow, because it's getting late on the East Coast tonight. We will have that for you. So if you want to share it with folks who aren't on Facebook, if you have colleagues who are not on Facebook, you'll be able to share it from the Heinemann blog. And the book, The Civically Engaged Classroom, will be out later this fall. So there's a link in the comments where you can learn more about that. We've gotten lots of folks curious about that. A lot of your students are coming out as well, former students of yours. Pablo, somebody who took a writing course with you, just gushing over your incredible writing skills and just your wonderful teaching. Mark, someone gushing about your beautiful classroom.
Yeah.
So lots of lovely comments in the comments for all of you. A lot of appreciation.
Brett, maybe we should just share a couple of resources before we go. So,
that would be wonderful, Mary. Yes.
Okay, so friends, this is a Padlet. You can see up here this little URL, but we'll also put it in a box in a second. But it's got a lot of resources to support this beginning work of building identities and exploring identities and amplifying identities at the beginning of the year. Mark, thank you especially for all. You're always so good at making really beautiful Padlets. So this might be helpful for you. And then let me just share with you from our, here we'll go forward. Right there, there's your URL or the QR code for it. So you could just take a picture with your phone and you'll be able to find it later. So you might wanna just take a quick snapshot of that. And we'll be sharing Padlets across the year, but this is an introductory Padlet that has a lot of work on supports and tools for doing identity work at the beginning of the year.
Perfect. And one of my colleagues from Heinemann will also post that link in the comments, and we'll also add that link to the Heinemann blog when we move the video over there as well. So, okay.
And these are our next two sessions.
Yes, perfect. I'm so happy. Perfect segue, Mary. Well, thank you to all three of you for doing this tonight. You know, Mary, Pablo, and Mark. We're going to continue this conversation next month. The date there is on your screen, September 17th at 8 p.m. Eastern time. Certainly want to be respectful of all time zones. And we're just going to continue this conversation. There's, as Mary and Pablo and Mark mentioned, there's different sections we're going to focus in on in the next two sections that we're going to do, one in September and then one in October. And in the meantime, you can learn more about their forthcoming book, The Civically Engaged Classroom, Reading, Writing, and Speaking for Change, by visiting Heinemann.com, where you can get a lot more information there about the book and when it's going to be coming out. So again, our many, many thanks to all of the wonderful people that have been watching and talking
so much.
And we'll see you next time. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Muchísimas gracias.
Good night. Thank you.
Good night. Good morning.